Hi everyone, hello, good evening, and welcome to the Alice in Wonderland virtual panel chat and discussion here. My name is Casey Mahaffey. I am a resident artist at A Noise Within, and we are here this evening to talk all things Alice. So the short of it is, around February of 2020, a group of us artists got together to start rehearsing this exciting, bold, and visual production of Alice in Wonderland. We worked our tails off for weeks and weeks and weeks, and finally it came for opening this big production. We had opening night. We had maybe, I think, a matinee that next Sunday in March. We had two performances under our belt. And then COVID happened and our production was shut down. All that hard work that we were so excited to share with the public was for naught, it felt, and we spent a year in our homes on our couches. And luckily, Jeff and Julia at the theater had the idea that we could all get together and get the band back together and work on Alice in Wonderland again for purposes of filming it so you could stream it live in your homes. So we got together. And there were four cameras, not unlike a sitcom like Will and Grace or Friends or Frasier or something like that, where we were on a set and we had four cameras filming it. And we did it over 10 days of rehearsals, including 2 days of filming. We filmed it in 2 days. And now it's available to stream. You can see our production of Alice in Wonderland in your own home. The last day of streaming is June 20th, so you'll have to go on to anoisewithin.org and look for tickets so you can stream this incredible and exciting production right there in your own home. So I'm going to start, we can get all the panelists popping up here, all the panelists that we have for our discussion today. I'm going to kick it off here. Once again, my name is Casey Mahaffey. I'm a resident artist at A Noise Within. And in Alice in Wonderland, I got to play an ensemble member, and I was the March Hare at the tea party. What else? Let's see. Tweedledum. I don't know how I got the short end of that stick, but I was Tweedledum. And among many other fun parts that we got to play, but those two I think were my favorite. So I'm gonna toss this on to Susan if you wanna tell us about you.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for tuning in here. We're very excited to talk about our Valentine Alice production that we're so happy that it came back. I'm also a resident artist here at A Noise Within. I play the mouse, I play the white queen, I play the red king, and the Victorian ensemble, the fab ensemble. So thanks for being here. I will kick it off to Bert.
Thank you, Susan. My name is Bert Emmett. I'm a guest artist with this production of Alice in Wonderland at A Noise Within. And I was very excited to also be in the ensemble and to play a playing card and a dodo and a mock turtle and the White Knight. And I would like to hand it over to Erica.
Thank you, Bert. Hi, everyone. I am Erica Soto, and I had the ultimate privilege of playing Alice in this amazing production. And oh my goodness, has it been a wonderful experience. I'm also a resident artist here at A Noise Within Theater, and I'm just so happy to be doing this really great panel with you guys, but not before I say hi to Raphael.
Thank you, Ms. Soto. My name is Raphael Goldstein. I'm a resident artist at Noise Within, and I had the great pleasure to play the Mad Hatter at the tea party, along with, as well as a crab and a playing card and Tweedledee and and a Victorian man, and and various other things, and it's a great pleasure to be here.
You know, we could talk about a lot of things with this play, but I think your crab work most notably needs to be mentioned.
It's all in this.
Okay, see, we're still learning. We're still
crabbing, so. I mean, it's very subtle work. Yeah, very nuanced.
Very specific.
Joy of film.
Yeah. You were method. You went there.
Yeah, totally.
So something I want to kind of start with, which, you know, everyone watching at home right now knows that during COVID times, we all started following protocols and rules to participate in society. 6 feet distance, social distance, wearing masks. And of course, our rehearsal process before we filmed was no different. We, in order to be able to do our production, we had many regulations set by the union and by the state of California. So we, I want to start by talking about, so A Noise Within is an incredibly physical and athletic theater company. Anyone who sees our productions knows that I'm usually coming down from the ceiling. Erica's flying in on some raft. Something's happening. Yes, yeah, something crazy is always happening. And so it's a very, very physical athletic theater company. So what happens when no one can stand within 6 feet of each other? Well, I think we're gonna start off, Raph, for you as an actor, especially when we already blocked the play in one iteration, right? Always touching each other. What was that like to come back and adjust for?
Yeah, well, I mean, it, as you say, it's a very, very physical show. In particular, Alice was a very particularly physical show. And with the Tweedles right there, God, our faces. you know, I mean, there's a lot of proximity. I mean, I always thought of the Tweedles as sort of like a two-headed dragon.
These pictures are of the production, right?
Yeah, pre-COVID production, where we could, you know, we could be mashed up against one another, and I think you and I, Casey, only ever were apart from each other physically during the Tweedle dance. The rest of the time we were physically connected, and we would give each other cues so we, you know, could, you know, turn our heads at the same time. So we gave that illusion of being one mind, and so part of the difficulty in doing this is we had to use other, you know, forms of stimulus to give each other cues, or to, you know, to just the way that we moved on stage was very different, it did lend a it was an interesting challenge, but I think at the end of the day we were able to achieve the same effect while maintaining distance and, you know, avoiding spitting on one another and all of that. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think every scene had to go through a pretty rigorous changes in order to get them up to COVID code, as it were. But yet, it was very important to Julia Rodriguez Elliott, who was helming this filming production, that we not lose any of our magic and our connection that our theater is so known for. So, Erica, I know there was a scene where I got to play the Griffin, this like retired rock and roll style bird. And you, now, I want you to talk about our original entrance versus the entrance that we had for the filming.
Yeah, so if I'm not mistaken, originally it was like, you know, the Griffin gives Alice a ride on his back, right? Like, and so we've got this illusion of Alice climbing onto the Griffin and flying through to visit the Mock Turtle. Which is really fun because you get to have some of that kind of, you know, more acrobatic physicality and connection physically. And with this, you know, we came up with what I think is a really clever and charming idea, which is this use of bicycles as our flying mechanisms. And that's kind of the cool thing about how COVID has forced creativity, right? Because I don't know that we would have even thought to do that, because it was just so simple to use our bodies to tell the story. And then suddenly we were able to like include something that I think is very appropriate to the world and to the childlike nature of what's going on, you know, because you were on this like big bike and then it was like tied with a string to a little tricycle, and you know, there was something really darling and fun about that, and kind of like little circus crew. Yeah,
there it is.
there it is, you know.
You said it so right, that necessity breeds invention, you know, and we're absolutely. here we we have this constriction with COVID, but, and while you used to fly in on my back, now the director came up one day before filming and was like, I think you'll be riding a bicycle, and I think you'll be towing a tricycle behind you. That's the kind of thing that we did when we figured it out. And yep. I think we may have a clip of the Stream Now performance of our entrance, 6 feet apart, but keeping the magic. So let's see that.
Brooklyn! Get out here, you lazy thing! Come on, get out here! Take this young lady to see the mock turtle and to hear his history. I must see after some executions I have ordered.
Oh, what fun!
What is the fun?
Why, she! Look, it's all her fancy that they never execute nobody, you know. Hey, come on!
I was never so ordered about in all my life.
Right, right.
Never!
Here we go! Hold tight! Oh. Hold on tight, yo! Round the bend, here we go! Whoa.
And there it is.
It was so fun, though. I loved it.
The funnest. And that's why I love working with Julia so much. I cannot speak highly enough. I mean, I think I've probably done 10 productions with her by now, but you know, it doesn't matter if she's transforming a prison, you know, in Man of La Mancha or doing this show, you know, and trying to not have the COVID regulations be a restriction, but rather just an opportunity was just so wildly impressive, I think, to all of us
Totally. I mean, the test of an artist, you know, the tighter the box you put them in and they're still able to work within, you know, to bend physics and time and space to fit within that box and still make something beautiful is astounding. It's really impressive.
Yeah, because some of the stuff, the physicality you were saying, how physical these productions are, Casey, you know, a lot of the physicality in this show was off stage when we were doing the first incarnation of it, because we had, what was this, 90 minutes long? Maybe not even. And we never stopped from the downbeat of the show. We're backstage when we're not off. It's like noises off backstage because we're changing and we're, you know, it's all so quick. In fact, Bert and I remember we would bring the table on for the Mad Hatter scene.
And oh, gosh.
And we had all these things that had happened, you know, backstage. So then in having to be creative, like Erica was saying, for COVID, you know, how do you keep that level of energy still on the camera when we don't have the benefit of that being behind us? So what I think is that the whole team came up. Suddenly you've got an editor helping that happen, right? Suddenly you've got more options with makeup that we had time to do because we didn't, you know, we were able to enter those scenes without having to do transitions before it. So it was kind of cool, but also challenging, you know, to keep that level of energy up.
Yeah, I specifically remember a moment where you were the White Queen, and our friend Julan, who's not here today, played the Red Queen. And I remember you guys had to fall asleep on Alice's lap. Yeah, there it is. That's from the original production with no, obviously, that this is pre-COVID, pre any of that horror. You know, to have those moments, to keep the magic in those moments, but not be able to do the physical contact was definitely a tricky thing, for sure, as you said. But Susan, I think what you're leading into, which is so true, was that once we were done finding out how to work with those restrictions, then the door opened into like, okay, rather than have them be a restriction, how can we take this medium of film, this new medium where we can cut between scenes, and how can we make this production better? How can we make it really sing? Well, one tiny example of this would be the opening of the play. Erica, you, I believe, speak to a cat for a few minutes. Is this right?
Yes, I have a lovely conversation with a little cat And that's kind of how we get into Alice's world, and you really get to know her. And during the live productions in the theater, you know, that cat was a stuffed animal that I endowed with a lot of life, you know? And that was great. And that was, I think, one kind of challenge as an actor, to be on a stage and try to fill a whole world, you know, with an inanimate object. But then,
but then
for the film, we had a real cat.
Such a diva.
And I don't know if you guys remember, but when we went to film this scene for the first time, and I went, and I completely forgot all of my lines because I now had a live animal in my hands, and I just didn't know anything that I was supposed to say. I mean, everything just went boop, just left my brain, because we were able to use a real cat.
And by the way, give that cat an equity card, because that cat was great, right?
Such excellent. Such a pro.
Very pleasant backstage too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, easy to work with. A little messy at times. No. So we none of us blamed you, Erica, because you went from having a stuffed animal that you're relating to a wriggling, writhing, live action animal in your hands while you're trying to spit out exposition and information at the top of the play. I do believe we have a clip of it. That I would like to see, if possible.
Kitty dear, can you play chess? Because when we were playing just now, you watched as if you understood it, and when I said check, you purred. Well, really, it was a nice check, Kitty, and I might have won if it hadn't been for that nasty knight that came wriggling down among my pieces. Kitty, let's pretend that you're the Red Queen. You know, I think if you sat up and folded your arms, you'd look exactly like her. Now, do try, there's a dear. No, you're not holding your arms properly. I'll just hold you up to the looking glass, and you can see how sulky you are. And if you're not good directly, I'll put you through into Looking Glass House. How would you like that?
Beautifully done. Beautifully done. God.
Unnatural.
Unnatural.
And by that I meant the cat.
It was just like, whatever.
Yeah,
I
one
did
of these.
It just kind of.
I just think one of the most even tempered animals I've ever seen on stage. It's
yeah,
crazy.
I thought for sure I'd get an eye out.
Oh yeah.
This has all gotten to her head though, and her agent has been calling and demanding higher rate wages. It's kind of been a nightmare.
Twas ever thus.
Star turn of her. What was her name, you guys?
Gatita.
Miss Gatita.
Miss Gatita, which is Miss Little Girl Cat.
You know, the other thing about social distancing in that scene specifically, like we're relying on her on Alice's lap, I actually liked, after I got adjusted to it, I liked being isolated a little bit, a little separate from Alice. It made her like in her own bubble, like she was something magical that we couldn't quite get into her space. I kind of like that actually.
Mm-hmm. That's so great. I think, and it's such a wonderful quality, Susan, in an artist to be able to take new information, new blocking, or let's say a new costume piece, and rather than reject it, accept it and work with it and allow it to inform a whole new thing, maybe, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's so definitely. Awesome.
Definitely.
Mr. Burt, you're on mute.
Sorry, I never know. I have a neighbor who's a go-kart fan, and I never know if he's going to fire it up in any second.
Oh.
But I was just saying, you know, in a situation like that, when you were previously fairly close and now you're more distant, you have to find yourself having to reach out in a different sort of intangible way, and there's more of a void, so you're kind of like drawing it up from inside to make that connection, which I think might even make it more vibrant.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I 100% agree.
Well said, Bert.
Yes,
so
you're here.
So Bert,
yes.
you're, Your work in this production is so beautiful. It's so nuanced and detailed. Your work is so detailed. And I just wanted to talk to you about, so other than Erica, who plays Alice the whole time, I think that's probably enough of a workload for her. We all played many characters. All of us got to play these Victorian sort of citizens. I wanted to talk to you specifically because, like, we all play these Victorians, but what other characters did you get to play?
Well, I think the first time I come on not as a Victorian is the Dodo, which is a strange thing in and of itself. So we're a bunch of birds
there
running on. We're all wet because Alice has been crying when she was a giant. And so we're trying to dry off and just negotiate with this new creature here. So not only are you a bird, you're also some sort of character in the world that Alice might be familiar with. So I chose for the Dodo to be sort of a pompous, stuffy fellow who thinks he knows everything and everyone else can follow him. But everybody else also took their, whatever their entity was, there's the crab again.
Yeah.
It's just a fish out of water.
And Casey, you were that little fledgling that still didn't have all its feathers on, thus the your skull cap looks like I'm wearing it right now.
It looks infected.
And Susan, that's you, the mouse in the middle.
The mouse trying to teach a story, this authoritarian little mouse, this cautionary tale. It's a very bizarre world that Alice finds herself into in this scene. And we come out from swimming in the pool and from the pool of tears. And so Julia, I love it. Julia Rodriguez is the artistic director, and she envisioned the pool of tears literally becoming a pool. So the mouse comes out with the diving board and we're swimming underwater. And it was very inventive, very magical.
Very.
And then all these creatures come out from this world. And it's just this fascinating, very bizarre scene. Very fun.
So would you say I know the answer to this, but I want to hear you say it. In playing multiple roles and having all these quick changes and having makeup changes and sprinting backstage to put on a new wig or a tutu, what was the difference between the two mediums, first doing it for the stage and then having the luxury of filming it with cuts and edits in between? Just addressing that to any of the ensemble, throwing that out there.
Well, I mean, personally, there was a lot less sweating. Because when we were doing it on stage, you know, for a live audience, you know, having to run through from, you know, you have 30 seconds to do a quick change, and the costumes are not simple. You know, I mean, thank God, you know, Maria Uribe and Angela, you know, they came up with some wonderful fixes for some of that to streamline the process. But they're still pretty complicated. And so you'd have, you know, sometimes 30 seconds or less to go from, you know, say a crab to a caterpillar with, you know, seven different parts to come on. And you have the space of a 15 second music cue. Right. Whereas, you know, and no makeup, because well, who can do makeup in 15 seconds?
Drag queens.
I guess so. Yes. but they're magical creatures.
They weren't in this.
I know. So the film allowed us to really experiment with makeup for the first time in this show, and that opened up a whole new world of possibilities. You can find levels of detail because the camera, you know, can get right there, and so you sort of need that added layer, and so that was fun to play with, I thought. Yeah,
I would second that. One of my favorite makeup parts was when to play the mock turtle. Angela had this idea of putting a base color on and then putting a fishnet stocking over my head and then dabbing new colors on it. So you'd get this sort of checker marked reptilian skin look for it. And that took a little time. So it was nice to have that time.
That's amazing. That was my answer too. I think that having that time for a cutaway, what was, as Raph said, a 15-second change of just mad dash in the stage production, then we had the leisure of take 45 minutes, get into this new makeup, and we're gonna set up this shot now. And that freedom gave that relaxation, allowed us, I think, to find new beats, new moments, new exciting things with the play that maybe weren't seen before. I think we might have, for example, a picture of the tea party here. So here we are in the stage version, because you can tell we're less than 6 feet apart, and you can see we're not wearing makeup because we had just played other characters 4 seconds before this scene. and then there we cut to this is the streaming. You can see we're socially distanced, but also we added some lights, some cool light effects, and switched a few things around, and you can see the makeup work that was done and wraps incredible face, whatever you do.
God, I look like a nightmare.
A nightmare that may or may not be going to the restroom.
Yeah, well, those are some big pants, you know, so, you know, who could resist?
You guys.
So. Justin, the biggest move there, Justin went from being on the table to then in front on the floor. But that was fabulous, that adjustment, you know? Mm-hmm. Who would have thought?
Yeah.
So, Miss Erica, yes. This whole journey for you, getting this part, playing a seven-year-old? Seven-year-old girl?
Seven and a half, exactly.
That's right, seven and a half, exactly. So do you want to speak to, I mean, I know this is a little bit broad of a question, but do you want to speak to your process in inhabiting this character, anything that stuck out with you in the journey, and then versus the streaming?
Yeah. You know, I have the pleasure of playing children on stage. And what I love about this, even though I am a 32-year-old grown-up woman, grown-up in quotes, I think, is that I can continue to sort of exercise that muscle of imagination and innocence and wonder and magic and all of the stuff that, you know, when I'm really honest with myself, is alive and well, and I think the world expects you to behave, you know? So that is always really wonderful. And so being Alice in this play kind of gave me that opening to really to live that out and to bring as much of that to the role as possible, and hopefully people feel that. So that's kind of been constant, but it was even more valuable to me the second time around filming it, because I'm like, oh my gosh, I feel myself getting a little emotional. I don't know why. Oh my goodness. But like, after such a hard year, you know. I can't believe I'm getting emotional, you guys. We're live. But like,
speak to it. I mean,
I think it was just so cool, because it was like an opportunity to like reconnect to wonder and magic and like fun and play and joy and curiosity and like, and also a world where you're like, what is going on? What is happening right now? Who are these people? What is this world? What am I? Who am I? You know, where are we going? And it really felt like a reflection of the time and a balm for the time.
Wow. So beautifully put. My God.
Wow.
Erica. Yeah.
So, oh my God.
Did you find anything in a year later two part question. Did you find any new information in the character in coming at it a year later, coming back to it a year later, A, and B, switching mediums, going from stage to having a camera right there doing close-ups?
Yeah. I think more than I was aware, the time kind of let the story and the character marinate for me a little bit. And having the camera allowed for some of the nuance that maybe I wouldn't have been able to lean into as much for stage, because you're trying to reach the person at the top row, allowed for us to kind of explore a little more, the story a little more intimately. Mm. Now, I think we were all still very heightened, which the story required. Mm. So I loved that we kept a heightened quality because we're still on the stage. We're still living in this heightened world and story. But I think what ended up really working that I couldn't have expected was the time meant I wasn't coming to it, you know, with a little bit of like that anxiety of when you've only got 4 weeks and like you really don't feel like you've settled in until like week two of the run, you know? And then of course it always happens that like on closing, you feel like I got it.
Yeah. You know, and then the show's over. Yeah. Right.
But with this, it was like, no, we got it. And then we had time. And then we could like chew on stuff a little bit. And I think that's in there. And so I would say that was a big part of my experience, kind of like coming full circle with it.
So I know you work a lot in commercials and television, and you do a lot of camera work. I have to say personally, my favorite takeaway from doing this play and streaming it and watching the stream instead of participating in it was being able to see your performance, because usually we're having a mad dash and switching wigs and flipping out and we're screaming and I'm usually punching Raphael just because and because he deserves it. And then this was so amazing to watch the work, the scene work that you had done, and to utilize your skills, your camera skills, when there were close-ups on you. And you weren't acting for the back row. Alice would have little thoughts, and it was almost like you were winking at the camera and the audience. It was beautiful. Thanks. And I just want to take a moment to recognize your incredible work in this. I mean, it's really something to take note of.
Oh, thank you guys. Thank you. I mean, I mean, all of us. We were just. It's just something that isn't possible without everybody being so committed to the story and to the world. And that was kind of. Was so wonderful. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And also you.
We can't do it without Alice, and you were our content.
Thanks.
Yeah,
that's absolutely. Really sweet, you guys.
No, I think we might have some more production stills of you if we just want to pepper those out. So here.
Look at us.
Are your feet off the floor? Are you flying?
Yeah. She's levitating.
Just a hair. I managed to get up there. Well, Casey's really tall, and I was trying to like jump at the same height as Casey.
Craig nailed that picture.
It looks like you're doing Peter Pan.
I love this.
Oh yeah. The spin. That was fun. I always felt like I was on a you know ride during that part for some reason. Like I felt like I was on a
Is this now was this from the streaming, this one?
No. You know, here's the tell. In the streaming, my hair is straight. Alice has straight dark hair. And in the live one, we curled it.
Why was that? Why was that?
I don't know. I think we just opted for a curly look. My hair was a little longer as well. Yeah. And now for the filming, it was pretty short. And I think Julia ended up liking the kind of bob, the kind of girlish bob, I guess. Yeah. So this is our staged version. Yeah.
Beautiful.
You also mentioned in that picture that the other resident artist Jeremy Rabb, who couldn't be here tonight, he stepped in as the white rabbit for the filming because Gabriel, who did the production, I think was out of town. There he is doing a film, and Jeremy just jumped. I mean, he's amazing. He just jumped in, and there he is.
The
lankiest
white rabbit you've ever seen.
The tallest white rabbit ever.
More limbs than ears, for sure.
I think you stood about 7'6" by the end.
With the ears.
From shoe to ear. And having him along was also the treat of the filming, too. We're all, of course, very close with Jeremy. And we were stoked that we were sad that Gabe got a movie, but stoked for him. And then we were even more stoked to have Jeremy hop along and join us, for sure.
And Justin and Julon, who are not here tonight also. So we should shout out to them because they're amazing.
Sweethearts, both of them.
Incredible group of people. So let's talk about some of us playing our favorite characters. Raphael, what's one of your favorite characters in this piece?
Well, I mean, you know, I got to give it to the crab, but you know, I mean, I always like playing with you, Casey. And so getting to do the Mad Tea Party and the Tweedles. The Tweedles, there we are.
There we are.
That's from the filming. From the filming. And that's from the stage. God, the subtlety there is just astounding. it's so much fun, you know, being a repertory company. You get to form these, you know, years long relationships, and I feel like, you know, being the Tweedles has sort of been like the closest we've gotten in terms, I mean, just physically. I mean, look at that. I mean, it's so much fun to know somebody else's rhythm and to be able to use that to the maximum advantage on stage. And then we get to do that wonderfully choreographed dance that always, you know, brought the house down. And it's just a joy.
I mean, it's time. Both times we did it.
We brought the house down. All two times. It's rare to get to be on. It's rare enough to be on stage, but when you get to be on stage and do something fun that is also makes you think, you work up a sweat. There's nothing like it.
Talk about the caterpillar scene. You guys looked like you had so much fun in that. And in the taping, I was like, I want to be in that scene.
Well, and for the filming, we got to add some bowlers and tools. So that's always, Julia Rodriguez and Bubbles. We couldn't, you know, because of the COVID restrictions, we couldn't actually use real smoke for the hookah. So, but we got to add it for the filming digitally. It's just a crazy play. And to be able to live in that world and be forced to not just play the bit, but to ground it in something that is that actually affects her and helps her or hinders her on her journey, was a joy.
Right. That's such a good point, because that's the goal, right? I mean, of course, Alice can be looked at as like just a series of crazy vignettes with these crazy personalities that we know of, the Cheshire Cat and the Mad Tea Party and everything. But really, you know, it was very important for Julia to have us find the truth of these characters, even if it is a crazy bird, and how we affect Alice, the verb to affect, like how we can change her on her journey to becoming the queen that she is by the end of the play.
Yeah.
And Susan, what were some of your favorite characters in affecting Alice?
Well, you know, as you talk about that, this sounds a little esoteric, but one of my favorite parts was the moment when we all come out, all the Victorian characters come out of the door. We came out of the sides for the filming, but we come, this is later, I think, on the train, but we're dressed like this. And we first appear as Alice opens the book and starts reading. In other words, we're coming to life through this child's imagination right here.
Oh yeah, there it is. Yeah.
I loved that because it's just so magical. And then it's so poignant at the end when we all go back, and I my moment of watching Bert, you know, take the crown back from her, take the book back from her, and just looking into these eyes of this girl, that this whole world that came to life for her through her, that was the most touching thing. So I think in that vein, the White Queen probably, because they had that sort of emotional connection.
Oh yeah!
Oh wow!
Which I really, really, really loved. But they were also fun, like Roth said. You know, I mean, I get to play a henpecked king. It was very fun. I'll probably not do that again. So that was
You were the red. The Red King? There you are.
Completely handpicked by my wife, you know, who's killing everybody.
I love the kind of gender bending moment there. I think that it was really playful and fun. And I think to have the incredible Justin Lawrence Barnes there as the Queen of Hearts playing, you know, the king opposite, or the queen opposite to your king, was a stealth move.
I love that they made that flip rather than keep with the genders. So that was so fun. But yeah, it's those poignant moments of watching these characters come to life through this child's eyes that gives me goosebumps.
Totally. And you talk about, you know, all these scenes are there for different reasons, right? Some of them are more comical. The Tweedles were obviously there for sex appeal and romance. That's obvious why they were not. But seriously, you know, so some of these were more poignant than others. And your White Queen scene with her really, it takes it from the whimsical and kind of language fun to like, there were really touching moments. And Bert, you have one of the most touching moments of all in the play by playing this White Knight. You want to speak to that?
Yeah, this is definitely my favorite character. And perhaps it's because of my age and physicality. I don't know. But of the Victorians, I was the sort of Charles Dodson, the Lewis Carroll of this whole thing. And I felt like if there was any one character that Lewis Carroll felt he was speaking directly or as directly as possible to his Alice, it would be the White Knight. And he's kind of by an example. He's like, here I am, I'm kind of getting up there. I try to do all these things that I think show how great I am, and I fail at every single one of them. But I will continually try to keep inventing. And so there's these sort of lessons that kind of fall out of this cereal bowl for Alice. You know, it's like, look at this great thing, but actually the lesson is kind of over here. And I think in the second half of the show, the White Queen, the Red Queen, I think the majority of the characters are saying, like, there's a thing for you to observe here, and even within the absurdity. But that was my favorite scene. You know, working with everyone is fantastic. But Erica, those were very touching moments. And it was nice with the book handing off. It's like Dodson kind of doffs his White Knight, and he's still there in a way. So, yeah, it was lovely. It was just lovely.
And the line that the White Queen says to Alice, that I think something about the imagination, you haven't been using your, you haven't been able to, what is the line? I forgot. Being able to use your imagination.
I say, you know, poignant. One can't believe in impossible things. And then,
you haven't had much practice. Yeah. And then you have to keep that alive. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So beautiful.
Yeah. And I agree with you guys. I mean those moments with, especially with the royalty and then the knight, I feel like it was Alice's moments with these adult figures, right? These authority figures that are coming through and handing her these life lessons. And there was something so maternal and paternal and aunt and uncle, like there was this familial sense. And I just personally, you know, would feel very touched, just as Erica, to have moments like that, you know, with you, Susan, and really feeling connected to you in that way. And Bert, I didn't even get started. It's so special, you know, to be sung to be told a story, and to have someone say, you're sad, and I see you, and I have a story to tell you.
Yeah, and that's also what made your performance so extraordinary too, Erica, because you weren't just inhabiting the body of a bratty 7.5-year-old. You know, you weren't just like accurately capturing, you know, like this girl wandering through, you know, these whimsical scenarios. You change over the course of the play in a really beautiful way, and you were able to hit all of those notes without skipping a beat, and truly impressive.
Thanks, yeah. And how great that you had that process, the rehearsal process and everything under your belt, because we shot out of sequence, didn't we?
We did, guys.
Like most TV and films do. So we had to go with what was rightfully so easiest for the photography crew to be able to shoot scenes back to back and in the most efficient way possible, as they do in film and TV. But that did take away from the arc. Yeah, exactly, the arc or whatever. But just any final thoughts on what it was like to be back in the theater after a year of being on our sofas and working together?
Saved me. I mean, you know, getting to, coming back out of lockdown, and it was my first real foray back into the world and around other people, and I couldn't have picked a better group to do that with. A Noise Within is such a special place for me, and being back inside those walls was restorative in the best way.
Without a doubt. I thought about this, you know, because I knew we were going to maybe talk about this. And I thought about, gosh, I wanted to be an actress when I was 12 years old. And I went to this college production, I've never told you this, at Oberlin College, which was near where I grew up, of Camelot. I remember the two, it was probably like students and a couple, you know, guest artists, who I remember the two artists' names to this day, the Guinevere and the Merlin, because I memorized it. I was 12 years old. It was the closing performance. And what I remember is the curtain call. And they were all up there together, laughing, they were crying, they were holding hands, and it was a family. And I thought, that's what I'm gonna do. That's what I wanna do. So without a doubt, coming back was because it feels like family. The theater, being in the theater. There's yeah.
Oh.
That was gorgeous.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was thinking it was like for a child who gets a fantastic Christmas gift and you play with it and then it somehow rolls under the couch and somebody sweeps you up with a bunch of busyness. And then a few months later, you're on the ground, but you see this present hiding under the couch and you go, oh, I forgot I had this. And the whole joy comes back. It's like, there you are.
Oh my gosh, Bert.
That's so good. That $20 bill in your winter coat.
I was going to say, I know. $20 bill in your jeans that you get. You're like, oh, God.
Yeah. Well, I think we'd be remiss to not also speak to, although we are actors, it's not all about us. I know that comes as a shock to us five. But our incredible audience base, our subscribers, our the people watching this fun little discussion at home right now and who have streamed Alice or have yet to stream it but plan on it, that's as equally important of a part as each other are, you know, as we are to each other. Having that audience, we miss you at home. We're talking to you right now at home. We miss you so much. We really do. And
we miss
seeing our regular faces. We miss our community, and our Noise Within family doesn't just exist within the walls of ourselves. It extends to you and to the community, and how much we miss that, and how much we cannot wait to get back. I know this was a fun exercise. Filming it was very cool, very exciting. But I think everyone's itching to get back into what we know, and as Jeff Elliott says, what we do best. What we know, what we do, and how to do it. And we all, and that goes for you, our audience at home, and joining us. And what you do best is celebrating with us. And we are so excited. Up next, we have our 30th anniversary season, which is wild. It will be in real life. It's IRL season, where all the information can, of course, be found at anoisewithin.org. But it is starting off with an Iliad, which was the other filmed production we had opposite Alice here. That is a one-person show that Jeff Elliott and Deborah Strang will be alternating nights. So we urge you to start looking at tickets for that and everything for next season. We're going to show you the final trailer to Alice in Wonderland, because if you haven't gotten your ticket yet, you got to get it, because June 20th was the end. Yeah. I want to ask my cohorts that I love so much, anything else, anything to say
Thank you for being our MC, Casey.
Well done.
Thank you very much.
As usual.
Well, shucks. Thank you. Thanks to everyone. At home, sit tight, get healthy, get well, and we will see you back in the fall. And until then, here's Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, it seems very pretty, but it's rather hard to understand. It seems to fill my head with ideas.